Welcome to our Law Ethics Workshop 2024. I'm glad you're able to join us today. We have a highly informative workshop ahead of us today with reputable speakers who will be dispensing much needed information that will hopefully provide much needed guidance and clarity going forward. Before I say too much too soon, I'd like to bring to the fore Mr. Bale, who will formally usher us into the workshop with a warm opening welcome and purpose of the day.
My name is Masara Medipale. Let me firstly welcome our distinguished guests, students, fellow colleagues, and you, the program director. It is with great honor and gratitude to welcome all of you in our Law and Ethics Workshop. In our midst, we acknowledge the presence of Advocate Unathi Poyo, who is a lecturer in the College of Law, and he will be talking about ethics in the law. I acknowledge as well the presence of Mr. Clarence Mabutla, who is the SRC Deputy President, and he will be talking about ethics and challenges faced by students. And we also welcome one of our own, who is Mr. Makahani. He is a student counselor at Ekurhuleni, and he will be talking about ethics and unethical behavior. Also acknowledge the student counselor, who is as well one of our own, who will be doing the closing remarks. Colleagues, you are all welcome. Therefore, the purpose of this workshop is to empower our third and fourth year students in ethics and the law. Because at times we neglect empowering them, thinking that they are about to exit and they know everything, whereas they can fall into a trap. Therefore, we want to ensure that at the end of this workshop, they are well equipped, they are well capacitated, and they are well informed about the ethics, which are the guiding principles, so that they don't do wrong. They always do the right things. They always exercise integrity and value their clients and their work. Furthermore, as I said, we want to empower them. We want to ensure that they are well informed. They have to be able to clarify between ethics and the law, because the laws are there to govern us and they are being created by the government so that we live in peace, we live in harmony, and there is always justice. We ensure that we protect our clients at all times, because failure to do that, our law students will be faced with penalties, and we don't want to see that. Therefore, students, please ensure that you understand the ethics behind the law fraternity, because you can be faced with ethical dilemmas, and you have to act accordingly in an acceptable manner so that you don't find yourself in trouble. By so saying, may I say to you, enjoy the workshop, engage with your speakers because they took time to prepare for you, and ensure that you have a pen and paper so that you take down the notes or take away whatever is important for you. Ladies and gentlemen, you are welcome and enjoy the workshop.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Masara Madibale. Now that you have blessed us with a warm welcoming, I trust we'll have a great session. Without wasting any more time, I would like to welcome our speaker for the first segment of our workshop, Mr. Fatwane Makahane. He's our student counselor and trauma counselor as well. He's passionate about research, has presented in various conferences in Africa, and has published numerous articles. He has completed His master's in educational psychology at the University of Pretoria and is currently a PhD candidate in psychology. Okay, so he will be presenting about ethics and unethical behavior. Okay, so I hope, Mr. Makahane, I hope you have a pleasant presentation, and fellow attendees, please pay attention and enjoy. The platform is all yours.
Thank you very much. My name is Lipatwan Makahane, a student counselor, as introduced there. Yes, that's true, whatever it has been said. Yeah, and I think I'm going to try to simplify this for law students, right? We speak about ethics in counseling. So ethics run across everywhere. So basically, based on the introduction, and if somebody says you have already presented papers and you have already published papers, one also need to, because people will go and Google, oh, who is this guy? One also has to have his own definition of things so that they will start to realize that really he is in academia. So having said that, I want to inform you that we are going to talk about ethics, and there's no justification about this. And we're not going to beat around the bush. We are going to try our level best to make sure that this ethics is the one that is required everywhere. So the presentation I put up there, it does not have my definition. I just want to put the one which I've got my definition. Right, thank you very much. Like you can see there, and then I will start by explaining to you as law students to understand the definition of ethics. And you need to understand why are we doing this workshop. I think our very good psychologist has mentioned to you the purpose of the workshop and so on. One need to realize that it's important to always, always, as a law student, not only law students, anyone who might be attending, to uphold the ethics, because these are the standard within which we are judged. And we become a highly distinguished people because of the ethics, and then to be respected, because all profession requires ethics. In this definition that I've put here, it's not my definition. As an academia, I should have put a reference there. Ethics are principles and values which together will rule or conduct and of conduct and laws. It regulate and guide profession. I want you to listen to that. It regulate and guide profession. It's not used as a yardstick or something to be able to stop you from doing things or innovative, because it is only used to regulate and guide profession, because there are people who are using the profession for their own benefit, not for the benefit of everyone. So therefore, ethics becomes a rules of conduct and laws which regulate and guide a profession, such as legal profession. So in legal profession as well, we have got ethics, and that's why we have got a lot of students who are flagged to be seen to be doing unethical behavior. We are not saying we call you because you have been flagged. We are just saying before you are being flagged on doing unethical behavior, let's rather help you to understand that when you are flagged, you know that you have breached the ethical code of the institution, which will later affect you in the way in which you run your business, in the way in which you run your profession. So therefore, it's important for us to be on par with everyone so that everyone will understand what the purpose here is, to make sure that when you are running your own profession, you are on the know, because we need you to understand what ethics is all about. They act as an important guide to ensure right and proper conduct in a daily practice of the law. So therefore, that's why they sometimes you may think people, when they say lawyers are liars, right? Lawyers are liars. And that's not true. It's just because we have got a scriptless lawyers who run for money instead of upholding the ethic of the profession. And those few lawyers, they damage the profession. So we want you to be one of those people who are going to protect the profession by doing the right thing. So you are going to be integral person. You are going to be honest person in a law fraternity, so that we can be able to know and send people to your profession. So let me look at the following ethic in law. So I have also coined my own definition based on the ethics of law. We have got honesty, independent, and integrity. Warren Buffett says, honesty is an expensive gift. One cannot find it from cheap people. All right, I repeat. Honesty is an expensive gift. One cannot find it from cheap people. So in order for you not to be cheap as a lawyer, to be not a cheap lawyer, you need to be always be honest. An honest person A person who's dishonest, it's a very, very cheap. So therefore, in order for you to be expensive, right, you need to be honest. That's what Warren Buffett is saying. So which means that honesty, you cannot find it from everyone. So be the exemplar and be the only person who will show that they are still expensive people by being honest all the time. Therefore, I coined my definition there for independence. You can also come with your own. So this one, you cannot find it in a dictionary. I just made it myself. It's an ability to think without influence of others. Independence. It's an ability to think without the influence of others. So rather, that's why they talk about thinking out of the box. That's why they talk about somebody going the different direction, not following the multitude. So therefore, if you want to be independent, you need to think differently and not follow everyone. When they are talking about the government or the municipality of so-and-so, it's very corrupt. You become the only person who is not corrupt that becomes independent so that you can be exemplar on that area. So there is no way wherein you can try to hide behind the bush and try to beat around the bush and say, because others are doing this, I'm also influenced by others. You can see the scriptural lawyers in the TV every day. You can see them even, you can see what, this is not a definition of how I want to be. So you need to look for a person who's represent the profession and then try to see their integral part, because in law profession, every time, they also train you to always be honest. You can hear people say, I learned my principle from George Bezos because he taught me that I must always be honest. I must always uphold the above ethical principle at all costs. Therefore, you need to think about those kind of things. Who do you represent? Because we do, no matter how the moral has gone so low, you are not going to be lowered by that. You need to think differently and not be like everyone. That is why we talk about the independence, the ability to think without the influence of others. That is why when you are doing the reference there, they want you to write in your own words things that has been said by somebody else to see that you can also be able to think independent. So copying somebody's work and referencing him, it does not make you to be doing the right thing. You need to think independent. What does he say by this on my own understanding? That's when you talk about the independency. So I also coined the other one, the integrity. It's an uncompromised honesty which includes high standard of moral and moral judgment. So in fact, when you are going to judge things in your own thing, you are going to look at the way in which you think this is how things should be based on your previous references, based on the way in which you see things supposed to be. You have got every way to look for wherein you can find that this is a moral attitude, this is not a moral attitude. So you make your own judgment, you can consult and so on. That is wherein when you talk about the integrity, it's wherein things are uncompromised. You do it beyond your own level of thinking, no matter how you are stressed or how much you are influenced, how much you are low in cash. When we talk about integrity, you don't take the underhand and under the table things. You make sure that everything goes according to the plan. So therefore, because everything that we do, it catch up with us. So therefore, there's no excuse or the lie that you will say to yourself, I'm only going to do it once, right? That once that you are trying to do, it will catch up with you. If you want to be a slave for someone, if somebody asks you to do a favor and they give you something, you are going to be a slave of that person until you die. I repeat, if you want to be a slave for someone, if somebody asks you a favor and they promise to give you something and they give you something, you are going to be a slave for that particular person until you die. Okay, that is why most people in the government institutions, there's political people, they are always beholden by simple things. I heard not so long another child somewhere in Western country in Asia, I think, he killed himself because he was exchanging nudes with some fellows from West Africa, and then they held him ransom. So because he was not willing to go through that, he committed suicide. Okay, so everything that we do, it has got a way of coming back to us. So whatever we do, we might be doing that when we are still low. But the higher you go, those things come back to you and haunt you. So always think about that. Whatever you do, think about the ramification of what you are doing and how it's going to come back to you. Whether you do good, the good things will come back to you in a multiple ways. When you do bad, the bad things will come back to you in a multiple ways. And unfortunately, it always comes when you're higher there because it wants to put you down. Everything that you've done when you are still low, it will come back when you are very high, so that you can be seen and exposed when you are very high. Therefore, in this slide, we're talking about unethical behavior in a law student. What is unethical behavior in a law student? Unethical behavior among law students can be concerning, as it may undermine trust in a legal profession. Imagine one person, Patuani, doing unethical behavior, and the whole profession is compromised because of me. Okay? And also, it affects the integrity of the justice system. So everyone, imagine how many times you have said, when they talk about police cars, they say, I don't even worry about those ones. Those ones are corrupt. Because of just one police officer who has done something out of line. So everyone is painted with the same brush. The same thing, if a law student or UNISA students only, not other universities, they are doing something wrong or cheating in the exam, it affects every law students. So don't paint the other law student in a with a wrong brush. Let us be the moral compass, which shows the world that UNISA students are the best and they are moral keepers. And ethical behavior amongst law students can manifest in various ways, such as cheating on exam. I repeat, cheating on exams. Okay, I think my good professor is gonna be talking about the issue of cheating in the exam. The what is that other owl that is watching you? What do you do when you are busy going up and down? Then the owl starts to flag you and saying you are cheating and so on. So all those kind of things, and the plagiarizing assignments, which means that asking somebody to do your assignments, that is part of the unethical behavior, because it's cheating. You are not the one who's knowing. You want to know the course content because somebody is doing it for you. And they imagine going to the doctor who did not study. Somebody studied for that doctor, and they said they want to operate you. How will you feel about that? You are going to the doctor and you are told that this doctor never studied a book. He does not even know theory. He never did practical. Somebody studied for him and he passed the exam, but they are going for an operation. How will you feel about that? It's the same as that. It's just that we are thinking it in a different way. It's just law. I'll learn in the process. There is no learning in the process. You need to learn, and by making mistake, your own mistake, not somebody's mistake, because you won't understand the course content yourself. You won't understand the law themselves. That is why you find that there's a lot of scriptless lawyers outside there who are doing the damage to the profession. Engaging in the dishonesty during internship or clerkship, or even displaying unethical conduct in a personal interactions, because you always extort money to some people. Said, you know what, if you pay me so much, I'll make your case to disappear. I'll speak to so and so. I know people from higher places. That alone becomes unethical behavior. And law students, you know that. And it doesn't start that very far. It starts when you are not being honest with your exam. It starts when you are not being honest with your assignments, when you are supposed to be writing at home your own work. You gave it to somebody else to do it for you. That is dishonesty and is part of cheating. So law students, you know that. It's not only for law students. You can also share it with the other people who are on the other profession, that we are damaging the profession by allowing someone to do the work for you. So ethics and communication. In the legal field, it's very important. One of the important aspects of ethics is communication. You always communicate. The principle of communication is you cannot not communicate, which means that communication is an ending behavior. Whether you are sleeping, you are communicating with the ancestors, or you are communicating with God, for us who are believing in Christianity. So you're communicating with God through your dreams, isn't it? Through your vision. So some communicate with the ancestors. So communication is an ending thing. So you cannot not communicate, which means that whatever action you are doing, whether you're sleeping, whether you're sitting quietly, you are communicating a message. Communication is largely about keeping your clients updated on developments regarding their money to you as a legal practitioner. When you are becoming a legal practitioner who represent people when it comes to road exempt funds, for example, you need to communicate how much they will get and what are the things that are needed. And not trying to inflate in order for you to take 75% and you were supposed to take 25%, you end up taking more money than what you are deserving. That is why you find that other lawyers or whatever you call them, advocate and whoever is going to court, because there are different kind of people who goes to court. Some don't even go to court. They go via the bridges and so on. They end up getting money from people which it doesn't belong to them. And therefore, they are dishonest, and as such people, they don't deserve to be in the law fraternity. That is why we talk about communicating. Communication can be, no matter how low we can be as your clients, you need to communicate and speak to our language, which we will understand, because this is your bread and butter. This is something which brings the bread in your table. This is something that brings your family to go on. And make sure that you are being honest and keep your integrity. If we are supposed to get 75%, they get 25%. Keep it that way and they explain to us how did you come to that, because we might not know how to come to that. It's very painful sometimes to see. They say this person was involved in a car accident. The lawyer took all the money. The person was only given 10,000 or the wheelchair and so on. The lawyers built a big house and so on. Where is the integrity? Where is the people's passion? Where do you practice this? Don't do law if you're going there for money. Go there if you want to serve people. If you whoever want to be the greatest, let him serve. The best will be added to them. So you always have to think in your mind. You need to communicate this to your people, your customers, your clients, whichever you use the concept like that in your law fraternity. So the bottom line is you need to always think about the benefits of your clients, because you are not more important than them. You are just representing them. So which means that, in other words, you are saying because of these terms that are used in a court of law, they might not understand what is being said. So I'm going to represent these people and I go back to report to them. And do not dilute what they are saying, because they are very important. They become the central part on the case that you are representing. So if you can be able to do that, and if you start from being able to be honest from the study, the undergraduate study, until you do our honors and masters and so on and doctoral, therefore you can continuously become honest, because ethics are backbone of your life. You will never go without ethics. Then ethics and independence. Independence of legal profession means that a legal practitioner, you should be able to communicate and conduct yourself with integrity. We spoke about integrity. We spoke about independence. That means be honest to the client regarding the prospect of the matter. Do not even try to. I once read a jokingly said the lawyer was leaning towards the client in court, said your case is unwinnable. So therefore, when I go out for briefing, just run away, because we cannot solve this one. Right? That's dishonesty. So therefore, you must always be honest with my client. As much as I want money and you to pay me, I'm not going to waste my time on this case. You are going to be arrested, because 1, 2, 3, I cannot go beyond this. That is honesty. I don't know how far deeper you guys do your things and how you're going to do your things, but honesty will put the client at ease. Uthini, you know what? I'm going to try my level best. I'm not going to lie about this. I'm going to be honest, but the judge will decide whether what I've told them, it worth you to be out in a bail or not. I'm not just going to make you be out on the bail, because I can see, Uthini, if you go out, you are not even transformed as yet. You are going to make more damage. In order for me to not be part of this, I'm going to make sure that you are being kept in while I'm finding you to be kept and become a better person, so that when you go out to the society, you can become a person of better integrity, unlike before. Means of refusing to enable corruption or being part of the corrupt activities. So even if they want to pay you more money, because that is what is happening in law fraternity, they will always promise you to give you more money in order for you to make the case disappear or to make somebody to be out. And then when they are out, you heard that this person has been taken out of bail, but he was already killed 4 people. Now he continues the spree of killing or raping or whatever. So you should feel the pain of trying to let that person. How do you sleep during the night knowing that you are the one who advocate for that person to come out so that they continue with what they were doing? If it was done to your family, will you be able to do the same thing now? So think about that when you are doing those kind of things, because it's not about you only. The community belongs to you. So we put your trust on you. So when we trust you, we expect you to act on our behalf, and you must always take the good judgment and put yourself on our shoes, put yourself on the community's shoes, put yourself on the shoes of that person whom you think is the lowest of them all, because their voice matters as well. Having said that, I want to thank you very much for listening, and then we'll wait for your comment if there's any or questions so that we can clarify about ethics. Thank you very much.
I started this course because I wanted to be a legal professional, a legal representative, representing people who are being accused of committing crime. So the court came to me the other day to say, no, I must go to Roman Catholic Church. I then went there. So now there's a question that came to me. If I'm going to be a legal professional who are representing people that have been accused of committing crime, am I serving the Lord and the people within the community correctly? So I just want a difference between the two. The prosecution, to be a prosecutor or the legal pro, the lawyer, like who are defending people. So I just want a difference there from the university, because this was my own understanding that if I'm representing people who are accused of committing crime, some of them, they did in fact commit the crime, but now they are denying. I won't know. So that's my question. I don't know if you understand me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Tabao. Mr. Makahane, can you respond to that question, please?
Thank you very much, Reverend and Tabang. Tabang, what does your conscience say? Let's not beat around the bush, Tabang. You spoke about going to Roman Catholic Church. The Lord talks to you about something and so on. What does your conscience say? If somebody is lying to you and you are going to continue with that lie, what does your conscience say? I'm not putting the Bible here because we've got different interpretation of the Bible. In my other life, I'm a pastor. So therefore, I do not want to impose my religion to you. What does your conscience say when you are going to be told the lie and he told you the truth that this is a lie? I mean, I did this based on 1, 2, 3. This was a crime. What does your conscience say to you? That conscience that tells you is an issue of moral judgment. When you talk about moral, it's what you know the truth, and you decided to distort the truth to suit you because the guy is paying you or the woman is paying you. So why did you distort the truth, which you have been told? Because of the sake of money. Money will never be a root of all evils, but people thinking are the root of all evils, and they use money as that, because without money, the world won't go anywhere. But at the same time, your conscience tells you the truth, but you decided to ignore the truth. I think, Tabang, you don't need the answer for that one. Go back and think for yourself. If you wanted to be a criminal lawyer, right, what is it that you want to achieve? You want to represent them, or you want to make money? Because that's where money is, because people will know. People who are committing crime have got a lot of money. Therefore, you will be paid a lot of money. If it's all about you wanted you to get more money, will you be able to eat that money in with a clear conscience? Or you will be able to say to yourself, oh gosh, this is what I've done. I will go and ask forgiveness from God. For how long are you going to be doing that, going back and forth, trying to ask forgiveness, because every day we'll be living a lie? But having said that, I don't want to become a moral preacher here. I just want you to go and think about it, whether you want to be a criminal lawyer. There's a lot of law that you can pursue. There is a property law. There is other laws that you can pursue. So decide which one you want to go to and why you want to go there. Having said that, I think if you've got a follow-up question, you can also do it on the chat. Let's wait for the others to comment on the other questions. Thank you.
In terms of honesty and integrity, you make an example of a lawyer who said this case is unwinnable, so the accused person must just run away. Was that being honesty and be honestly in integrity? Why didn't the lawyer say that, just handed yourself to the police instead of running away?
Okay, thank you very much. I was just giving a background of dishonesty there. You got it all right. That was dishonesty. That's why I'm saying to you, you must avoid things such as that, because the truth is, you have to hand over your client, no matter how much they paid you, and then you need to be honest with them. If you're an honest lawyer, you will be rewarded because of being honesty. Even your clients will come to you because they wanted, some of them, they're not coming to you to protect them. They are coming to you to help them hand themselves over, because they cannot hand themselves over, because they wanted somebody who's going to talk on their behalf, so that when they are handed over, either their sentence will be minimal or whatever the situation might be, but at least they've gone through the lawyer. That's what they want. So Please don't ever try. Sometimes you need to find out when you are busy there. I do not know how law works deeply because I'm a psychologist. You need to ask the client, what do you want at the outcome of this? All right. They tell you the truth. I want to be out. You said, but why do you want to be out when you have done 1, 2, 3? Right. If you are not comfortable to work with that kind of person, let them pass and go to somebody else. OK, and then get people that are going to be comfortable to work with. I can't, as a psychologist, work with a rapist. I have to refer them. I tell them straight, you are coming to me to help you to deal with the thing that are going through and you rape the person. No, I can't. Can I refer you to somebody who's dealing with that? Not because I hate money. No, I like that. But the bottom line is I will never again in my life, because I've got girls, to think about rape to me. It's a deep thing to me. It's a very, very serious matter. So therefore, they must go to somebody else who are comfortable to work with that, not me. That's how I am. So you need to think about those areas with the balance of probabilities. So there's a share of pain. You balance the sharing of pain. Whether to live with this, helping this guy every day, watching him that he has done this much pain to some families, mean I'm going to protect this person. Can't I just refer them to somebody whom I know to deal with that better than I do, because I might become emotional in this case and I'm not going to handle it the best way. That's how I deal with my issues. So I want you to understand that there is always a level of competency to everyone. So when you reach your level of competency or things that you cannot deal with, refer to the better person who can deal with that one. Thank you very much.
Okay, guys, let's move on to the next speaker before we waste any more time. Like I said before, he'll be presenting on the ethics and challenges from a student perspective. We have Mr. Clarence Mabutla. He's a student doing honors in public administration. He is a current National Student Representative Council Deputy President and the NSRC Delegate to the Students Disciplinary Committee. Okay, so Mr. Mabutla, please, the platform is all yours.
I'll be presenting the challenges faced by law students, in particular to the ethical conduct. So the College of Law is responsible for producing the upcoming law practitioners in the noble profession. And as such, the key elements that are fundamental are morals and principles. So the institution, UNISA, as an ODEL or CODEL, is entrusting students with the responsibility of being ethical in their assessments. Like the latter speaker raised an issue of honesty. And then currently, there is an issue of unethical behavior in the institution of plagiarism, which is challenging not only the College of Law, but many other colleges. And that speaks to our ethical conduct as a student. So there are core causes which leads to this unethical behavior, such as plagiarism, cheating, and being unable to paraphrase. And I'm going to expand on those aspects. So what is cheating? Cheating is like copying the work of another person during, I'll first start by defining it properly. So cheating is defined in this way in the context of the students populace. So cheating includes, but it's not limited to the following, copying the work of another student during assessment, allowing another student to copy your academic work, buying of scripts with answers from tutors or from the internet, sharing of your assessment answers in Telegram groups, WhatsApp groups, and etc. And also going to the point made by the latter speaker of honesty. If now you cheat now as a UNISA student, and then you complete as a cheat, then now you must go to the bar exams. How then will you cheat there? So also it means that you're not being ethical during your years as a student. It will also come and haunt you post completion of your qualification. So you must be very ethical from the onset as an upcoming law practitioner. And as well, plagiarism. Plagiarism is an act of taking words, ideas, and thoughts of others and presenting them as your own. Plagiarism includes copying and pasting from any source without acknowledgement and not including references to your academic work and paraphrasing without also giving the source of the information proper acknowledgement. And as such, some of the issues which are faced in the College of Law is the matter of of citing properly. Like for instance, there's a module which use the O-Scholar. Students must know how to use the O-Scholar because you just take information, don't reference it, and then you present it as if it is your own, which is unethical because it is not your own information. And like the other speaker spoke about the issue of independence. When you take information from a source and then you just reference it without applying your own understanding to it, it is also wrong as well. So the issue of paraphrasing. Students nowadays, they just take information from the source, other prescribed book, the prescribed books or the study guides, and they just use these AI tools and they don't apply their minds to the comprehension of the content of the information. So as well, I'll just be here to come and clarify the issues in terms of the preventative measures to the session, which is that students in the College of Law, you must at least try and familiarize yourselves with the tutorial letter 101s, as they contain information regarding your prescribed referencing methods. And then also students must not copy and paste word for word or verbatim without giving acknowledgement of sources. And students must also avoid buying answers from the internet sites like your Gimme Notes, Stavia, and the likes. And also students must be ethical during assessment by stopping sharing assessment answers during exams and when doing portfolios. So I think I'll just stop there for now. Thanks very much.
Okay, so now we're going to our last speaker who will be presenting on the ethics in law. We have Advocate Unathi Poyo, who's one of our own, a UNISA lecturer under the College of Law.
My name is Unathi Poyo. I am a lecturer for the Department of Criminal and Procedural Law at the College of Law at UNISA. I have been a lecturer at UNISA since 2016. I have also worked as a compliance officer. I have worked in the private higher education institution as well. So I am here today and I'm very, very excited about engaging with students. I've noted the true presentation from our previous speakers and I appreciate them very much. And I have a presentation. However, I just want to indicate that I am speaking from a place of experience. So certain things are not necessarily in my presentation. I will just be going on and speaking to colleagues and students about what ethics in law is. Practically speaking, more so experience that I've had as a lecturer, experiences I've had as a member of the legal profession. So ethics in law. When you are a law student, I'm gonna start very softly because I think law students are still learning. You're still trying to find your feet. So I don't want to bombard you because when it comes to ethics, I strongly believe that it's also important for you to also have your own moral compass that you look on when it comes to being in a person of ethical an ethical person. So here is a list of sources where one can make reference to what we commonly refer to as a code of ethics. So as a person, you have your own moral compass. The university has policies, institutions, and governing structures that govern the legal field or any other profession that you are in, legislation, mainly the constitution, academic writing, and research. So I just want to go and speak about legislation and the constitution. And the reason I'm going to speak more about that is because I noted one of the questions from the audience members. Tabang, if I may please just address your question quickly. You spoke about if I'm representing a person. who is committing a crime? Am I serving the people or my community? I didn't get the entire question, but I got the gist of it. And I just wanted you to note, as students, especially law students, you must remember that we are governed by the Constitution. The Constitution is the supreme law of the land in terms of Section 2 of the Constitution. Therefore, any act, any law that is inconsistent with the Constitution is invalid. And the Constitution in Section 35 specifically says that every person is regarded innocent until proven guilty in a court of law. So when a person comes to you and they say that I have committed, I need a lawyer. Most of the time people aren't going to come and say I've committed the crime. They say that I need a lawyer because I have been accused of committing crimes. Remember, and up until a court of law says that you are guilty of a crime, we are dealing with accused persons. So you as a lawyer actually do have a legal obligation to defend a person who is accused of a crime in terms of the Constitution and in terms of applicable legislation. Now, whether you as a person agree with whether that person did commit the crime or did not commit that crime is another situation, which is dealt more in depth when you are in law school and you also have an opportunity to discuss such matters when you are in practice. So right now, as a law student, your duty when it comes to ethics is understanding that you are governed by certain laws, and the Constitution is the one that you need to focus on primarily. Now, there's another one that I want to touch on that was asked by the first student who said, when he made reference to the example that was made by one of our speakers to say that you can advise your client that this is an unwinnable case, that was very funny. I think I saw that meme. Remember, when you are practicing and you have a client and in your legal opinion, you see that this client does not have a case on merits. Remember, guys, when you are in practice, we use a lot of technical terms. So on merits, your client doesn't have a case. Now, you can advise your client, listen, your case is XYZ, and I advise you to either plead guilty or I advise you to not proceed with this case, and therefore, this is my advice. However, you may not force your client to take your advice. That's very important. That is actually part of professional ethics that you will learn in law school. You do not force your client, you advise them. Now, should your client not take your advice, you are more than welcome to have them sign a document to indicate that I did advise my client in such a manner and my client did not take my advice. And if you proceed with that client, you are supposed to defend them to the best of your ability, because again, the Constitution governs that everyone has a right to legal practice, reasonable representation. So therefore, if you proceed, you are therefore still supposed to defend your client to the best of your ability. So this is what I mean when I say that not everything I will be discussing is in the slides. So I was hoping to have a discussion with students about what you define as ethics, but I'm not going to do that right now. Let's have that discussion at the end of this session where you engage with us what you regard as ethics, because I think it's so important to have an understanding of what students regard as ethics so that we are able to also engage with you to say, this is actually not necessarily what is required of you as an ethics, as a student, as a law student, as a practicing law student, or on moral grounds. So there's a thin line when it comes to law, ethics, and morals. You guys are third year. I heard that you were third and fourth year. So when you did introduction to law, you actually did where it was defined what law is, it was defined what morals are, it was defined what principles are, it was defined what ethics are. And sometimes all of these are intertwined, and sometimes it may seem that a person who is acting in accordance with what is required of them as a lawyer is not necessarily being moral. So when we come together in the legal profession, we must always remember that we, yes, I come as a person of moral, I come as a person of integrity. However, I do have legislation and I do have governing structures and bodies who also come in and indicate to me how I am supposed to act as a person in the legal profession. When you guys go to law school, and you have ethics as one of your subjects, you will realize that the ethics exam is not what one expects an exam is. They don't ask you questions about, is this what, define what ethics is. They give you scenarios. That's what the ethics exam is. And I'm not sure what the case is in 2024. However, when I was in law school, ethics was one of the most failed subjects when we were writing our admissions exams. Everyone was always so scared about the ethics exam because I can't use the word difficult. It was just a different exam because of how it was structured, because of what information was required from you. So now I'm going to go and I'm going to discuss ethics in the higher education space. This is now when we are talking about you as a university student, academic integrity, right? Because when you have your studies. I wasn't sure if everyone in the session is a law student, but since they are, then I can comfortably continue in that regard. UNISA has policies on academic integrities, right? You guys can go on the UNISA website and you can look. I actually encourage you to go and look at the university policies that have to do with academic integrity. It's so important so that you guys can actually have a broader understanding and not just rely on what is told to you by your lecturers or by your peers. See for yourself what these policies actually say, and it gives you a much better understanding of it. From the moment you begin your studies, right, from the first subject, you are required to be someone of who understand ethics. And the thing is, When you are a first year student, it is the previous speaker did indicate that it's a ODEL institution. You are nervous, you are not sure where to start, so you rely heavily on other peers, heavily. I know this. I'm a UNISA alumni, so we did rely on each other to assist when it comes to the work that we needed to submit. However, at the end of the day, it needs to be your own work. So one of the things that I wanted to also touch upon is the previous speaker said that one of the reasons why students find themselves in situations where they do commit plagiarism is that they aren't able to plagiarize. And I want to tell you guys something that one of the lecturers that I had when I was in law school said that still sticks with me to this day, and it assists me in everything that I do. He said, as a lawyer, when you do anything, ask yourself why. So when you are reading an article for the purpose of doing your research for your LME module, right? When you are reading that article, ask yourself, why am I reading this article? Why am I reading this particular portion? What about this portion is speaking to the work that I'm about to do? So if you know your why, then you are able to have comprehension about what you are doing. And then when you are now getting ready to write, it's a matter of you being able to just paraphrase from a place of understanding. Because when you write verbatim, it becomes an issue. And most of the time people do write verbatim because they don't understand what they actually just read. If you don't understand what you just read, you won't be able to paraphrase. So if you understand, which is where the why comes in, you'll be able to find paraphrasing much easier, right? My next slide is plagiarism and ethics. Plagiarism is a form of unethical behavior. It's a form. And we speak of it mostly in undergraduate. Now I'm speaking on my experience as a lecturer. As a lecturer, we see a lot of my module, I forgot to indicate which module. I am a lecturer for the module Legal Research Methodology, which is LME 3701, and Research Report, which is RLLB 81, which is on third and fourth level, respectively. So the research aspect, the major research aspect of your undergraduate degree, we are part of, me and my colleagues, and I think that is where we do see a lot of challenges when it comes to students. And if anyone has ever attended our discussion class, we do have a slide when we discuss plagiarism and we indicate to students what plagiarism is, what cheating is, and what they can do in order for them to be able to avoid plagiarism. So I didn't want to repeat that, but I'm just going to speak up on it briefly. I'm going to appeal to your human side. And I just want to tell students, we understand the challenges that you face. We understand that some students don't have laptops and some students don't have resources, and some students it's difficult, your workload is heavy, and so on and so forth. But I want to appeal to you to understand that the consequences of being found guilty of plagiarism and having to deal with those consequences like a disciplinary case doesn't just end there. It doesn't end there. So when you plagiarize at this level, you guys are third year students. You are literally almost there. You can see your degree. You can see your future. You can see where you are going. So at this level, it is up to you as the student. You are the one that is actually in charge of what you do ethically. After you get your degree and you start practicing, it's the Legal Practice Council that's in charge of your ethics. But at this point, it is you, and you are accountable to UNISA. You are accountable to the university, to the Department of Higher Education. You are accountable to your fellow peers. Because remember, when you go out there and you say that I have a degree from UNISA, you want it to hold water. You want to be proud of it. You want people to say, UNISA students, no, definitely UNISA clamps down on plagiarism. It doesn't play like that. It's a very ethical degree. When you are sitting in an interview, you don't want, like our previous speaker said, you don't want to have questioned whether or not you are someone who is ethical, because there is just this high number of people committing plagiarism and cheating. No. So let us be accountable at this point in time, because we are still teachable. As students, you are still teachable. You are still able to say, no, I can do this on my own. And I'm not saying that don't go and work with other students, but I'm just saying, remember, UNISA has a zero tolerance policy against plagiarism. And as someone who has to do investigations, have forms, sits in disciplinary committees, I honestly know it sounds simple, but I feel bad. I feel bad when a student is having to face disciplinary committee. There's no other way for me to put it. I genuinely feel bad. And for me, it's a matter that is avoidable. When I do my discussion class and I discuss plagiarism, I discuss ways in which you can avoid plagiarism, because as a student, when you are able to plan around your work, it's easy for you to be able to do the things that is required of you. Now, I'm going to discuss the consequences of plagiarism. As you can see, we have a judge who's indicating that this is unacceptable. They are angry. And unfortunately, I just have the... I thought it was going to show the entire document, but it's fine. This is the UNISA student disciplinary policy. This disciplinary policy indicates the composition of the disciplinary committee. It indicates the process of the disciplinary committee, and it also disciplines the it also indicates the outcomes. Now, the outcomes of a disciplinary hearing is suspension, expulsion, or if I know with LME, if it's your first time being caught plagiarizing, you can admit that you plagiarized, and then thereafter you are able to say that you are plagiarized and you indicate that you will not do it again, and then you do receive a zero and you redo the module. If you want to go through the disciplinary case and defend yourself, then you have the composition of the student disciplinary committee, and the committee has different findings. So they can either suspend you. The committee has a discretion on how long they suspend you. They have a discretion on whether or not they expel you. Now, the one consequence that I want to speak to mainly when it comes to plagiarism and ethics at UNISA is your admission. So you have your degree. Let's say you were found guilty and you were not necessarily, you were suspended for a couple of years or whatever the case may be. And you go back and you have your degree now, and then you have to be admitted. UNISA has to give you a letter to say that you are a student from UNISA, you completed your degree with UNISA, and therefore you have no matters, you have no student disciplinary matters against you. So that's the letter, and that's what it represents. It is part of your admission papers. It is a requirement of your admission papers. If you are someone that is that doesn't have that letter, or you are someone that was found guilty of plagiarism, you are seen as dishonest. You are seen as dishonest. So if now you don't have that, or you have that and indicates that you have been found guilty of plagiarism, the Law Society can oppose your admission. And now you have studied and it was all in vain. So yes, the disciplinary committee by the university is very severe and it's very dire, but you not being able to be admitted is even worse, because now you have a degree. What are you going to do with your degree? And yes, you can find other careers, but the problem with dishonesty is that it follows you everywhere. I remember reading a labor law case where the labor court indicated that when a person, so this person was applying for a job and they have a conviction, a criminal conviction, and the labor court was touching up on criminal convictions, and they said that this person was fraud. So they said, you know, one of the biggest issues with a criminal conviction such as fraud is that the element of the crime of fraud is dishonesty. And the relationship between an employer and employee is one that is founded on trust. So when a person has an element of, has shown that they are a dishonest person, it is hard to establish the principle of trust in that working relationship. So that is why when someone comes in, and they have a conviction, they actually look at what crime did you commit, and is there a principle of dishonesty? Because trust is the basis of most relationships that govern working people, that govern adults, that govern society, and so on and so forth. So we're always trying to balance those things. And it all goes down to what I said in my first slide. It all goes down to what I said in my first class. As a person, your own moral compass will always be what you stand on when you are moving in life. And when you do something, right, you must always remember that you are accountable firstly to yourself, and then you are accountable to everybody else. And if you practice unethical behavior at a tertiary level, it is highly unlikely that you will be able to gather yourself enough for you to be able to practice once you are an attorney or once you are an advocate. People aren't going to want to work with you because people don't trust you. Remember, trust is the principle in which people build their relationship. Clients, if a client knows that you have been found or are guilty of dishonesty at some point in your life or unethical behavior, I mean, would you trust the lawyer that has been found? No, you will be living under a dark cloud, knowing that you studied so hard. And one thing I want to say to you guys, I understand sometimes that it's pressure, but remember, when it comes to ethics, there's such a fine line. There is such a fine line. So it is so important for you to always make sure that your own moral compass is one in which you use to conduct yourself as a student. Because when the legal practice council does it, when you are practicing, it's a whole different ball game. So at UNISA, we have several modules in which academic honesty plays an integral part of the outcome of the module. And these are the modules that I indicated I am part of. This is LME 3701, RR LLB, and professional ethics. Professional ethics, I am not part of, but it is also a module in which you guys have to study and learn about ethics in the profession, in the noble profession, as a student, and so on and so forth. So you will have the tools that you need in order for you to go into practice and understand what is required of you as a practicing lawyer. Turnitin is a proctoring tool that UNISA uses to assist academics. And this is also a teaching tool. Remember, they indicated that sometimes students find it difficult to paraphrase, or sometimes they don't cite, and so on and so forth. So you as a student as well, you are able to see, okay, I see that my Turnitin percentage is a bit too high. Maybe I need to work on my assignment. I know the university has different proctoring tools, so I'm not going to touch too much on that. But I just need you guys to understand that, remember, because we are online, and again, we want to make sure that our degrees and our modules are have integrity. This is why we use such tools as Turnitin to assist us in upholding the standard of the university. Okay, so law and ethics. Even though generally accepted definition of ethics speaks of morals and principles, in law we are governed by the Constitution, the law, governing bodies such as if you are whatever practice that you are in, the legal counsel, law society, and so on, the profession itself, which is fondly known as the noble profession. Now, I'm just going to speak of the practical experiences that I have as a lawyer. When you finish your degree and you are in law school, every opportunity that lecturers have, they will be speaking to you on ethics. One of the reasons is because as a lawyer, an attorney, let's say now you are an attorney. As an attorney, you have your trust accounts. And the thing that was always, always, always said, you must remember that the trust account is not your money. It's not your business's money. It's not your money. You don't dip into the trust account. You don't do anything. And I think our speaker referred so much about this when he was indicating about lawyers who do not pay RFA matters and so on and so forth. It's because in principle, if you, from the word go, just ethically tell yourself that I will not, regardless of how hard or how tough times are, touch my trust account. It is not my money. When the RAF pays out, it pays into the trust account. It is not your money. So ethics is that's the role that it plays when it comes to the practical aspects of you being a lawyer. You need to know that you are held accountable, not just by your own moral compass. Now, remember, now you are in practice. Now you are dealing with people's lives. You are dealing with people's matters. You are dealing with people's money. It is no longer just a matter of your own moral compass. Yes, your moral compass is a foundation. However, you are now accountable. And your accountability is that which people will use to judge you and the type of lawyer that you are. So ethics is taught from law school to practice. So this is, my document is gone. This document is an exam of the ethics exam that you have in law school. And this is the code of ethics by the Legal Practice Council. So I went through the Law Society's code of ethics and the legal practice. So I see that there's a lot of similarities. So if you guys go on Google, you can actually just see the code of ethics and what it says. And I would, again, I would encourage you to go through it and look through it. So before I end off my session, I didn't want to speak too much, colleagues. I wanted you to engage you. I wanted you to ask me questions. That's why I didn't have a long slide. Before I continue, I wanted to say this. Please note that we are not trying to scare you. We are trying to appeal to you as law students to say that you will have a lot of opportunities in which you are tested. You will have a lot of opportunities in which you will find yourself in difficult situations. And I know, again, I said I'm a UNISA alumni. It's not as easy as the people would like to make it out. I know social media always has things, but it's not easy being an ODL student, contrary. But the bigger picture must always, always just encourage you to be someone who wants to be ethical. And you also don't want to work. I have personal experiences of people who have been removed from the role of attorneys, who have been removed from the role of the bar. So it's very hard to start from scratch after having worked so hard. So I was here and I wanted to actually just appeal to you to say that it might seem like it's a small thing sitting with your friend and writing your assignment, but it's not. And also I forgot to mention this. When you are doing an assignment with your friend and you submit, I'm going to use LME as an example. You submit on LME and you did a bulk of your work, but your friend submitted first. Turnitin is going to pick it up as you copying your friend. So when we see the report, it gives us the detail of who else has that same work and their student number. And remember, because they submitted first, it's going to seem as if that person had the work and then now you copied from that person. And I just wanted to make you conscious of that. Okay, sorry, I just went going through my notes to see if I covered everything. Colleagues, If you have any questions for me, I think this is the end of my slide. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you very much. My two questions are directed to Advocate Boyo, and they are difficult questions, I must say. Apologies for being unfair to you, Advocate. The first one is, if the law does not reflect the moral compass of the society wherein it is being operated, doesn't a higher duty then arise? I'm saying this because I appreciate the points and the lectures to students regarding plagiarism and everything related thereto, including the consequences. But are we one day going to have a situation whereby, I don't know if it is DHEC or some other board that is going to oversee the conduct of universities in as far as the same thing is concerned, the works of the students being used and formalized in some other way without the very same students being acknowledged for their academic works? I hope it's a discussion that we will have, but you can answer that. But the second question is,
I wanted you to note that, remember, the University of South Africa and every university and every higher education institution is governed by the department, by DHET. And every qualification that we have has checks and balances in place in order for it to meet with the requirements of the regulations, policies, and standards that are set by the Department of Higher Education and the Council of Higher Education. So it doesn't end with UNISA, it doesn't end with lecturers. We also have a higher body that requires us to meet a certain standard. That is why every degree is able to compete at the same playing field once a student receives it. Now, in terms of your work being used, I think you said, you must remember, as a university student of South Africa, your work belongs to the University of South Africa. My master's degree belongs to the University of South Africa. Any postgraduate work that you did, any undergraduate work that you did as a student of UNISA, as an employee of UNISA, the research that you have done belongs to the university. You are the author, yes, but it belongs to the university. What you're touching up on is copyright law. So it's a bit more difficult in that regard. However, you must remember, ownership is that of the university. Hence, the university is able to now go ahead and use that work because it is the owner. It's more complicated than that, but I just wanted you to take cognizance of that. And remember, UNISA also underwent an LLB review. It was in 2016, 17, 18, in which we had to restructure our LLB curriculum, which is also something find as a student, that how this year I was able to do this module, it's no longer offered, or I have to be credited for this module, it's no longer offered, or now I have to do another module, whereas this module wasn't there when I started. It's not just at UNISA. We are accountable to the Department of Higher Education. We also have checks and balances that we have to follow. That's why we will always make sure that whatever we do, we keep in line with what is required of us as a university as well. Thank you. You can continue with your second question. I hope I answered the first one.
Okay, let me be quick and direct my question to Advocate Boyo and the other speakers as well. And without background, in the interest of time, colleagues, is it possible, is there a mechanism for people like Valentine and the others who don't have, because I think Advocate Boyo spoke about one's own moral compass being the foundation. Is there a mechanism where I can apply to whichever court, whether it's the High Court or any other, for me to be exempted from referring to human beings as my Lord and your worship. And while on the platform, and this is the last one, I'm sorry for taking too much time. When you are a criminal lawyer, remember you've got to represent the duty. You've got a duty towards the profession. You've got a duty towards the client. You equally have a duty to the other side, and so on and so forth. And I'm trying to paraphrase what Mr. Thabang was saying earlier. Which interest or which duty supersedes the others? That's a difficult question I'm throwing to the advocate there. Thank you very much for the platform. I will listen on Teams here.
Thank you, Valentine. Your first question, I'm going to say that I actually have never come across that question. I think when we finish and we go into practice, we sometimes don't interrogate the things that we find. So referring to a judicial officer, in the magistrate court, you refer to them as your worship. And in the high court, if it's a male judge, you refer to them as my lord. And if it's a female, you refer to them as my lady. We found it like that. I personally have never interrogated it. And I think it's a practice that's always been there. It's part of us referring to it as the noble profession, correct? So I think if one were to try and do historical research specifically on why we refer to judicial officers in such a manner, then maybe we would be able to establish whether or not we could stop referring to them as such, or we could find a way as to, can we no longer refer to them as such? I will say this though, Valentine, respect in the courtroom is held in such high regard that if you were to practice and you wanted to interrogate this, as much as it's not nice, the reality of that would be that you would be seen as someone who is not respectful. But that's a whole different thing. That's just, it's one of those, when it comes to practice, it's not necessarily the same as what you read in the textbook, right? We all understand that principle, that sometimes the textbook and practice is not seen in the same way. So I'm really not sure if there's an institution in which you can appeal to in order for us to stop referring to judicial officers in that manner. So perhaps if you can do the research and come back to me, I'd actually be very interested to find out why we refer to them in that manner and if we can stop. And then you referred to the duty and which duty supersedes which your clients or that of the opposition. Remember, when you are in practice, you have a duty to your client to represent them well, but you also have a duty to the court. You have a duty to the court to inform the court if there's anything that the court requires of you. I'll give an example with evidence because I am in the Department of Criminal Procedure and that's where my experience lies. So when you have a client who has committed a certain crime and they alert you to a certain piece of evidence, you have a duty to inform the opposition, and you also have a duty to inform the courts of whatever evidence that you find. This is part of discovery. And should you not inform the courts will frown upon that. And yes, saying that the court frowns upon that is just seen as a word, but it is actually very serious. It's a serious matter to have a court frown upon any actions of counsel when it comes to proceedings in court. So your duty, yes, your duty is that to your client, but you also have a duty to the court. Those are some of the things that you will learn when you are in law school and you look at court rules. In law school, you guys will be discussing court rules. They will explain further when it comes to what is your duty as a practicing legal practitioner. I hope I answered you, Valentine.
So we're talking about the ethics and unethical as a law student. So now, let's say I have a client who committed murder, and then now he's arrested. And we know by committing murder, it's like he violated Section 11 of the Constitution, the right to life. So it means that he took someone's life. So by the time he's arrested, he then tell me that I plead guilty and I know that I've committed murder. But because the Constitution, they say that you are not guilty until proven so by the court. So because that person told me that indeed he did commit murder, and then must I still represent that person, like, to defend him that no, my client did not commit murder because or intentionally, but he did so because of certain reasons?
Thank you, Wayne. I think your question is more procedural in nature. When you have a client who comes to you and they commit murder, and unfortunately, once a person says that you want them to, they want you to represent them. If you do not represent them, then you need to account to the Legal Practice Council why you don't want to represent them. And I don't want to use the F word again, but unfortunately, I'm going to use it. It is frowned upon for you to say this person committed murder. I don't want to represent murderers and so on and so forth. So you need to actually account why you say, because then now it's going to be a matter of, then that means you don't want to be a practicing lawyer, because people are going to come to you having committed crimes, and it's not your job to crucify anyone or to judge anyone. Yours is to defend them. When they come to you and they say that they're guilty, you, it's a procedure in terms of the Criminal Procedure Act. You go, when you appear in front of the judge asks this person to plead. Remember, there's always that process, whether they plead guilty or not guilty. If they plead guilty, then they are taken through the process in which they are, the judge will then say, okay, do you plead guilty? And then the person says, yes, I plead guilty. The judge needs to ascertain that this person understands that what they are pleading to. If this person understands, the judge is happy that they understand what they are pleading to, then it is dealt with in terms of the Criminal Procedure Act, and then they continue. But your deciding whether or not you're going to defend them, it's not a matter for you to just say, yes, I will, or yes, I will not defend my client. You, like I said, you are accountable to the Legal Practice Council bill, to the Legal Practice Council. So if you don't want to defend clients, you need to tell them why you don't want to defend clients. And because they committed murder is not something that would be acceptable to the LPC.
Okay. Now, because I once went through this other case whereby they will say if you plead guilty, you will get a light sentence. But then if you don't plead guilty, where else you know very well that you have committed such thing, you will get like a maximum sentence. So I don't know, like I fail to understand, like, why is it that when you plead guilty, they promise you that you will get a light sentence, but then if you don't plead guilty, you round around, you'll get like a maximum sentence whereby when the court finds you guilty. So I don't know, like.
Okay, so that's an administrative matter. It's administrative, okay. Right? It's just one of those systems that are in place in order for courts to be able to function well. Remember, when you plead guilty, you are, in some sense, showing remorse, which can be seen as a mitigating circumstance. And then the court then will be able to, but the prosecutor is the one that discusses with your attorney or with your advocate whether they will give you a license. It doesn't automatically happen when you plead guilty at first instance that you will get a life sentence. Remember that. And also remember, when I said that as a lawyer, one of the things that you must always remember is that you are also accountable to the Constitution and other legislation. One of those legislation is the Minimum Sentence Act, right? Now, the Minimum Sentence Act says that there are crimes in which when a person is found guilty, they have to serve a minimum sentence. Whether you pleaded guilty at first instance, your first court appearance, or whether you pleaded guilty after a court case and so on and so forth. Now, I don't know every section of the Minimum Sentence Act, but there are certain acts that if you commit this crime, you have to do a minimum of X amount of years.
All right.
They take that into consideration. Hence, when a prosecutor, I don't know if anyone has ever seen a charge sheet, and sometimes they'll tell you, you'll have a person in on the face of it, this person only committed one crime. But the charge sheet, this person has 10 crimes on the charge sheet. Because again, administratively, it's a maneuver that the prosecution does in order for them to be able to show that, okay, maybe I might not be able to prove robbery, but I can prove theft. I might not be able to prove assault with intent to cause grievous bodily harm, but I can just prove assault. So the prosecutor, again, it's just a maneuver. Like I said, the textbook and practice sometimes might not necessarily be the same. Most of these things you will get to experience when you are in law school and practice. So when it's not a hard, fast rule that when you plead guilty at your first appearance, you will get a light sentence. It's something that is negotiated between your the prosecutor and your defense, and the court has to accept that sentence. If the court does not accept that sentence, it does not accept that sentence.
All right, thank you.
No problem.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, afternoon,
Inati and everyone else. I just have a question around, what was that?
No, continue, Tembi. Temba, okay. Is it? No, who's speaking? I'm sorry.
Right now, I was about to go to our next question. I'm going down the list. So please, that's why I ask everybody to mute their mics and only unmute them once I call your name. I'm going down the list. That way we can try to answer as many questions as possible, guys, please. The person I was going to next is Thabang Anthony. Is it Thabang? Mufoka. Thabang?
Oh, yes, ma'am. I thank you very much for this opportunity for me to raise my two questions for Advocate Poyo. Sorry. Advocate Poyo, I was busy taking screenshots of the slides from your side. So I wanted to know, should I want to use that information, how can I state it where I got the information? Because remember where information is coming from, to state where the information is coming from is very important, because they can go there and check if I did get the information. You'll see. Okay, right. My second question, madam. I would like to know about the scenario of the case labor matter that you've told us earlier. Where can I get the judgment? And then the parties who were involved in that judgment, because I'm interested in that case to look at it, as I am young Nelson Mandela from another family, trying to groom myself to do better in the future. I thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Thabang. Your first question, I think most students know that we use a scholar. A scholar is the referencing style that we use. Now, when it comes to the presentation, I think what is important, because a scholar doesn't necessarily have how to reference PowerPoint presentations at a workshop, what is important is for you to indicate the name of the author, Unathi Boyo, the title, then you would say PowerPoint presentation, ethics and law, right? And then you will indicate the platform in which you found it, and then you'll say that UNISA ethics and law workshop hosted by, and then you will indicate the date. You'll indicate the date in which the workshop was hosted. And the importance of indicating dates is because information is forever changing, it's forever developing. So in order for you to be able to keep up with trends and being relevant, you need to know, okay, this particular date was the workshop and this was the presentation. Is it still relevant? That's why it's important for you to use dates. I will send me an email. I'm going to write my email address in the chat. Send me an email and ask me to send you the case. I have it in my files. I have lots and lots of files. I have a lot of cases, so I'm just going to have to go through my files to find it, and then send me an email and I will send you the case. Thank you, Thabang.
So as we all know that we growing up in a country like myself, right, growing up in an environment where a domestic violence and LGBTQ actually in short has been taking place since my childhood. So I growing up in a family where parents were always fighting and other stuff. So that is the reason why I decided to choose an LLB. So I was busy deciding on choosing a career in LLB. I come across a challenge where I was facing a fear because of the motivation I was getting from the people. I don't know, maybe they were lying or not. I've been told that you can just complete your LLB degree and not getting an employment. So my question is, what should I do after completing my LLB degree? This is my first question. And then, I mean, actually, what steps should I take after completing my LLB? And then the next question is, I need an explanation. I don't understand. I only heard about it and I only saw a few things happening. So I want to understand. Please explain to me, what is an implement of justice? So I want to understand a little bit about it.
Okay. I'm going to speak to you about your first question, which I think is more of career. It needs a career. What can I call it? Career counselor, right? So when you are after your degree, you can either go to law school, or you can find your articles. So most people do their articles and then they attend law school at night, or if after law, after your, and you pay for law school. I don't know if you guys know this, but you do pay to attend law school. So if you do your articles during the day, then you do law school at night, and then you can just go to law school full time during the day. So my advice to students will always be that try and look for articles now. You guys are third and fourth year, correct? Try and look for articles now. And it's okay if you don't get articles in the big firms. Lots of smaller firms, boutique firms, they call them, are also looking for people who have studied law. If you are a full-time student, this is now for people who are full-time students. If you can also try and find, I think they called vocational programs where you study, where you work, summer programs, vocational summer programs. So you can look for those. You can try and get mentors. So if you are in a particular field, if you are in a particular field and you need to, you're interested, go out, put yourself out there, send people emails, tell them I'm interested, can I shadow you, can I do whatever is required. So just put yourself out there from now on, after this session, start putting yourself out there, start putting your CV together. If UNISA is holding any community engagement, if UNISA has anything that pertains to students, join so that you have stuff that you can include in your CV and try and stand out. So it starts with you right now. It doesn't start after you have your degree. It's actually very difficult once you have your degree, because now you're starting from scratch. So if you start now, then when you have your degree, then you have direction. There's a question about AI that I saw in the chat. If I can please just answer that quickly before we move, because we are living in a AI-related or AI society, basically, when everyone, what is your opinion on AI paraphrasing tools? I don't endorse it. You can use it if it's to your advantage, but I don't endorse it myself, because I am someone who believes that when you are working as a legal practitioner, people are coming to you because they want your opinion as a lawyer. They want you to be able to assist them. And when you are looking at the law, in order for you to be able to draft whatever you need in terms of the law, you are doing so as a matter of interpretation in order for you to be able to clarify to the court that this is the matter that you are bringing forth to them. So when you are using a AI tool, it's very generic and it might not necessarily speak to your client as well. I remember when I was in law school, one of the conveyancing lecturers told us that when they were, this was in the 1980s, when they had to write the conveyancing exam, they actually had to draft the entire deed document themselves, and it helped them because they were able to pass. And right now, if you look at the pass rate for conveyances, it's very low, because we've now gotten to an age where we rely so much on technology that we don't know how to draft the actual document ourselves. So if, for me personally, if you want to be an asset, I would suggest that you rely less on AI and try to do it yourself. How long is law school? Law school is six months to a year, depending on whether you're attending full-time or you're attending part-time.
We'll move on to the next segment, which is the last segment of our workshop, our closing remarks and vote of thanks. So we are going to have one of our student counselors who's based here at the Johannesburg Regional Center, Ms. Mamashu Mabua.
Thank you so much for bringing me on the spot, on the last minute arrangement. But, I just want to actually give vote of thanks to everyone who has attended this workshop today, especially our students, because, I mean, if it's not for them, then it means that we're not going to be hosting these kind of workshops. We really appreciate your presence in this workshop, and we are hoping that you are going to stick with us until you graduate. Your interaction in this workshop as well, it shows that you were listening, it shows that you were present in this workshop, meaning that even our speakers, they would not feel they would not feel like they were just on their own. So your presence, your participation, it was acknowledged, and it shows that you really want to, you wanted to be part of this. Thank you so much for honoring this invitation and for being here. To our speakers, starting with Mr. Makahane. Mr. Makahane is our student counselor in the Gauteng region, and I know him to be a very good speaker. He did really well, because as the student counselors as well, having to be registered with the Health Profession Council of South Africa, we also adhere to the ethics of our work and code of conduct. So him speaking about ethics and how to adhere to the values and ethical behavior, it wasn't because of, you know, just being touching there and there. He knows exactly what he is talking about. Gasped Ibarre Sriti Samo to see Baring My Sorama would say Agata Sriti Samot. Yes. So in that, meaning that for as long as you behave well, then even your dignity will be preserved. Mr. Clarence Mabutla, you really did well in your presentation, for the fact that you are actually sitting at the realm of, you know, student representation. We really appreciate you being part of us, because this also shows that our students are well represented, and you also adhere to the ethics, because you cannot talk about something that you don't know about and you do not practice. So we really appreciate you, sir, and we are hoping that we are going to engage with you even in our future events. Advocate Unathi Boyo, from what I hear, you are the initiator of this workshop within our Gauteng region through our head of counseling, Dr. Bitswane. This shows how passionate you are about your work and what you want to see in our students. Their success means so much to you, and we really, really, really appreciate you for that. And as well, we are hoping that we are going to engage with you going forward, you know, just being there here and helping students how to prepare for the journey ahead of them. I heard you saying you are not trying to scare them, but you just want to show them what lies ahead of them. And that is very much important, because at least now, for those who did not do career counseling, they did not go through career planning or career guidance, they know what is there. And also, you know, the new students that are here, they now know that there is turn it in, there is a lot that they should consider. And honestly, like she said, UNISA does not tolerate plagiarism. So you need to be sure. You will hear people saying, students from UNISA, they are coping, they are doing that. Get in and you'll see what actually happens. For as long as you are outside, you will think that what they are saying is true. But once you get into the space, you'll realize that that is not the truth, and you will be taken out, especially when you plagiarize. So thank you so much once again, and thank you to the team that worked tirelessly to ensure that this workshop becomes a success. I just also want to make a note with the same space, on the same space with the same students. We are going to be having law professional events on the 17th and 18th of July. This is actually for all the law students, where we invite law professionals. We also invite the governing bodies in the law fraternity to come and speak to you, as Advocate Boyo has said already, but there will be those ones that will add up on this as a preparation as well for the career ahead of you, for the journey ahead of you. So you are going to get the invitations, and once you do, please register, please keep in touch with our post on social media, our Facebook page, Gauteng Region, and as well as being on alert on your my UNISA to ensure that you don't miss out on anything that we are running for you guys, because everything that we are doing here, we are doing for you, and it can never be us without you. I'm wishing you all the best of luck when you're preparing for your assignments and eventually your exams, and make sure that whatever that comes forward as part and parcel of your success, you make sure that you work hard for it. Thank you so much, and thank you, the program director. Thank you, Gauteng Regional Team, for organizing this workshop. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mamashu. Okay, guys, so that's our workshop. I'd like to thank all of you guys for attending. I see someone said that it was very short. Yes, it was short, but very impactful. I hope you guys were able to absorb as much insight as possible. I myself would like to thank all our presenters, our speakers. Truly, truly informative session. Please give a round of applause, show love. Like Mamashu previously stated, that we will be having further engagement. So this is not the end.